Welcome back to the topic, very complex topic, ovarian tumor pathology. If you have a look on this particular chart, you may get surprised. So many types are there, but still we have few favorite questions among this entire so many entities. So let us have a look on this classification as such. These tumors have been classified as surface epithelial stromal tumors. Most of the time we come across these surface epithelial tumors only. These other tumors are very, very rare, and they are very interesting for us to report as such in the histopathology. So surface epithelial tumors, we classify them as serous and mucinous. Again, the subtypes are benign, borderline and a malignant. Again, benign are very, very common. Malignant, you should remember, they are known for causing the pseudomyxoma peritoneum. Endometrioid carcinoma. So 30% of the endometrial carcinoma patients that is there in the uterus, they can have a chance of development of the endometrioid carcinoma of the ovaries. Brenner tumor, you should remember, it is nothing but looks like a exactly transitional epithelium, so urothelium. So it could be benign, most time it is benign, it could be even malignant. So rarely we come across the clear cell carcinoma, which exactly looks like that of the RCC, renal cell carcinomas. Germ cell tumors, again, most important tumors, second most common to the surface epithelial tumors. Very, very common is the mature cystic teratomas. So most of the time it is mature. Rarely we come across the immature teratomas, which are considered as malignant, or we will come across the stroma ovary, which will secrete the thyroid hormones, and it could be caused for the hyperthyroidism status, and even it can some more times we can have even the carcinoid tumors as such. In the carcinoid syndrome also can be associated with the teratomas. And we have immature, that is without any differentiation, they are called as dysgerminomas. Exactly resembles that of a seminoma of the testes. So again, the cells will have that fried egg appearance, clear cytoplasm, very prominent macro eosinophilic nucleoli, and dense lymphocytic infiltration in the stroma. So with differentiation, yolk sac tumor, which is known for development of the Schiller dual bodies. So this will again ask in the exams, Schiller dual bodies are seen in yolk sac tumor. Remember, yolk sac tumor is also called as endodermal sinus tumor. And we have embryonal carcinomas, very common in the predatory case population, known for extensive hemorrhage and necrosis. And we have a choriocarcinomas, which are again secrete the beta HCG levels, which are very, very raised. So some of the tumors will have a tumor markers that also you should remember. Then we have a peculiar rare tumors, sex card stromal tumors, but this is most important, granulosa cell tumor, which is known to produce excessive amount of estrogen, and it can, because of the precocious puberty or hyperestrogenic status itself, you know that it causes the risk factor for the endometrial carcinomas and even the breast carcinomas. Microscopically, it will have a Karl-Exner bodies. That's again a favorite exams question. Karl-Exner bodies are seen in granulosa cell tumor, and the cells will have a coffee bean appearance of the nucleus. Thecoma fibroma group, again rare tumor, but whenever it occurs, it causes a peculiar syndrome, so called as Meek syndrome. So Meek syndrome may be seen in the patient with the bilateral fibromas and thecomas. So there will be bilateral thecomas or the fibromas, and they can have a ascites and the peculiarly right-sided hydrothorax. That's again, they will ask in the MCQs, what is Meek syndrome? So androblastomas, again, they can cause for the masculinization or even sometimes feminization in the females, very, very rare tumors as such. So but as the steroid or the lipid cell tumors, again, rare tumors, and they can secrete the steroids. And the most, again, is the Kuchenberg tumor, which is nothing but bilateral ovarian metastasis of the stomach tumors or the pancreatic tumors, breast carcinomas. So they can go to the both the side of the ovary and cause the symmetrical enlargement of the ovary, and it shows adenocarcinoma of the, that's metastatic adenocarcinoma in the ovary. So we call it as Kuchenberg's tumor. So it appears little complex, but once you memorize this chart, you can answer so many MCQs easily. So these are the few MCQs what we usually expect in the chapter of the ovarian pathology. So let us have a look on these ovarian tumors, very interesting topic. So this is the surface epithelial tumors are the most common. Around 70% of the tumors are the surface epithelial stromal tumors, followed by germ cell tumors, followed by sex card stromal tumors. Metastatic tumors are very, very rare as such. So different types of surface epithelial stromal tumors, mainly it is a serous tumors, sometimes even mucinous tumors. Again, they are classified into three categories: benign, borderline and malignant. Benign are called as cystadenomas, for example, serous cystadenoma or mucinous cystadenoma. Malignant are cystadenocarcinomas. So usually mesenocystoid carcinoma is the one which is known for the pseudomyxoma peritone. Other surface epithelial tumors are endometrioid carcinomas, clear cell carcinomas and the Brenner tumor. Germ cell tumor classification, if you see, it's a huge. Mainly if there is a maturation, it causes the mature cystic teratomas or benign cystic teratomas. Rarely they can undergo malignant transformation. That's around 1-2% of the cases will develop the squamous cell carcinoma is the most common tumor that arises from the benign cystic teratomas. And if at all they don't show any differentiation, then it results in the formation of dysgerminoma, which is malignant tumor, counterpart of the seminoma. If at all they show differentiation, either primitive differentiation, that is embryonal carcinomas, extra-embryonic differentiation, yolk sac carcinomas, then tropoblastic differentiation, choriocarcinomas. If they remain immature, then we call it as immature teratomas. Sex carcinoma tumors, mainly it's a granulosa cell tumor and tumor of the coma fibroma group, known for the Meek syndrome. Stromal cell tumor, we call it as androblastomas, very rare tumors. They can cause either the feminization or the masculinization. Lipid or steroid cell tumors, again very, very rare. And metastatic non-ovarian tumors, mainly Crookes and Buck tumor. So with that brief introduction, let us proceed to the classical, the ovarian tumors. As such, remember, 80% of the ovarian tumors are benign. That point you have to remember, most common tumors of the ovary are the benign tumors, mainly surface epithelial tumors are the very, very common. Usually seen in the reproductive age group, whereas malignant tumors are common in the little bit elderly age group, 40 to 65 years of age. So around 20% of the tumors are malignant. The risk factor for ovarian tumors in general are the nulliparity because of the hyperestrogenic status. Family history, again important, the BRCA1 and BRCA2, especially BRCA2 is important for the ovarian tumors. HER2 new mutations, P53, of course, as you know, it's an important tumor suppressor gene, will be mutated in 50% of the cases. So surface epithelial tumors are benign, borderline malignant. They can be small or most of the time they are huge. They are fill the entire abdomen and patient will come with a huge abdominal mass. So we will classify them as grassly itself. We can make out that they are serous or mucinous based on the content. So it is a straw yellow color, like a watery, then it is serous. It is a thick gelatinous, it is a mucinous. So cyst adenomas, if at all there is a papillary excretions, we will, on the grass itself, we will use the word papillary cyst adenoma, or sometimes they can be papillary cyst adenocarcinomas. Cyst adenofibromas will have equal amount of cystic, that is a glandular component, as well as the fibrous matrix will be there. Cyst adenofibromas, again rare tumors. Histogenesis, they said to be derived from the coelomic mesothelium, or it could be also due to the mesothelial inclusion cyst that can give rise to the cystic tumors as such. Most of the time they are benign, rarely they are borderline and rarely malignant. So 40% of all ovarian tumors belong to the serous tumors. So most common ovarian tumor, if at all in general they ask exam, so it in exam you have to answer that it is a serous cyst adenoma. Serous cyst adenoma is the most common tumor. And most common malignant tumor of the ovary is again serous cyst adenocarcinomas. So cyst adenoma, whenever we tell, it shows the serous lining, that is low cuboidal epithelial lining. You can see the beautiful cilia over the surface. So sometimes even apocrine snouting can be seen. So there is no invasion in the underlying stroma. Fibrocollagen stroma will be there, ovarian stroma will be there. So sometimes they can show papillary excretions. If it is papillary excretion limited only to the inner cavity without any infiltration, then they are serous papillary cyst adenoma. Still they are benign. If at all the tumor cells are infiltrating into the stroma with all the features of anaplasia in these glands, then it is serous cyst adenocarcinoma. So by grass itself, most of the time we come across these papillary excretions are there. So such a solid area, we will give more bits. If at all is totally cystic, it is most of the time it is benign. If at all any solid area you see in these tumors, then that particular area we have to grass extensively to look for the malignant cases. So this is papillary excretions can be seen in the grass itself. So microscopically also you can see these papillary excretions protruding into the lumen, and they are also infiltrating into the stroma, showing all the features of malignancy: hyperchromatic nucleus, prominent nucleoli, high NC ratio, and all these mitotic figures. So these indicates that you are dealing with a carcinomas, serous cyst adenocarcinomas, papillary serous cyst adenocarcinomas. Mucinous tumors are quite rare as compared to the serous. Around 25% of them are mucinous, and most of them are mucinous cystadenomas. Benign tumors are very, very common. Mucinous are very, very rare. Whenever mucinous tumors occurs, they are known for pseudomyxoma peritoneum. So, usually seen in the middle or adult age group. So, grassly you can see entirely tumor is multilocated. External surface is also showing a congested capsule. Cut section, it shows thick mucinous secretions. Some may be filled with even serous. So there can be a combination of sero and mucinous. Sero mucinous tumors are also common. But have a look at these papillary structures. Whenever you see papillary structures, you should be careful. They can harbor a foci of the malignancy. That area has to be extensively grassed. So mucinous cystadenomas, we show tall columnar epithelial cells like this. No any invasion, so no features of anaplasia. This is over in the stoma how it appears. So benign are the one which will have no problem at all. So they remain benign throughout the life. Malignant are de novo in malignant. That means they arises as a de novo. Benign usually never turn into malignant. So pseudomyxoma peritoneum, you have to remember, it is extensive mucinous deposition of the tumor. So it indicates extensive peritoneal implantation has taken place. It causes the dense adhesion between the intestinal coils, and it can cause the massive ascites. So ascitic fluid you send for the histopathological examination. For the cytological examination, we will see these malignant glands in the ascitic fluid as such. They can cause intestinal obstruction. It could be cause of death, and these will usually carry very aggressive course. If at all there is a pseudomyxoma peritoneum, it indicates that only chemotherapy can little bit improve the patient's life, otherwise it carry very, very bad prognosis. So this is one of our cases recently showing the malignant glands in the omental fat. So this is omental fat, omental cake they had sent, and they suspected clinically as a tuberculosis because it was appearing intraoperative like tubercular miliary seeds, but microscopically we proved it as pseudomyxoma peritoneum. Later on we come to know that patient had the mucin secreting adenocarcinoma in the ovary. Endometroid tumors, so this 30% of these patients will have associated endometrial carcinomas. So they constitute around 20% of all ovarian cancers, and 5-year survival rate is not actually so good for these endometroid tumors. Rare tumor is Brenner tumor. Most of the time it is benign, rarely it can turn into malignant. But what you have to remember about Brenner tumor, you will see nests of transitional epithelium like urothelium, that what we see in the kidney, in the renal system, that kind of epithelium may be there for the Brenner tumor as such. They will have a dense fibrous stroma around these transitional epithelial nests. Figo staging is important to predict the prognosis. If the tumors are limited totally to the ovary, they are stage 1. Involving both the side of ovary, one or both side with the pelvic extension, it is stage 2. Involving both one or both ovaries with the peritoneal implants outside the pelvis and positive retroperitoneal inguinal lymph nodes, then it indicates stage 3. Stage 4, where distant metastasis is seen in the lungs or in the liver and to the bones. So many organs can be get involved. So staging is the one which will decide the prognosis of these tumors. Germ cell tumors constitute around 15-20%. Most of the time they are the teratomas, and they show homology to the testicular tumors. That means you will see germ cell tumors so in the testis as well as even in the ovary, and they will have same names as well. Except like seminoma, we call it as in testis, we call the same tumor as a dyscherminoma in the ovary. So dyscherminoma is the counterpart of seminoma. Around 2% of ovarian tumors are dyscherminomas, usually seen in the second or third decade of life. So remember, both the seminoma and dyscherminoma melts like an ice with a radiotherapy. So the radiosensitive, 96% of them can be cured if they are confined to the ovary. And remember the name, don't confuse with the suffix oma. They are always malignant. So dyscherminoma is benign or malignant, seminoma is benign or malignant, both are highly malignant tumor, but respond very much well for the radiotherapy. So both dyscherminoma and seminoma will have this peculiar fried egg appearance. So they will have a clear cytoplasm, very distinct cell membrane, very prominent nucleoli, eosinophilic macronucleoli, dense lymphoid infiltrate in the stroma, fibrocollagenous stroma. Sometimes there can be giant cell formation, granuloma formation in the fibrocollagenous stroma. So this is how dyscherminomas and even seminomas will appear. The name yolk sac tumor, remember the alternate name endodermal sinus tumor, both are one and the same. They are rare tumors, usually seen in the young population, and they are known for one of the important tumor marker, alpha fetoprotein will be positive, whereas alpha 1 antitrypsin will be also positive. Maximum survival is around 2 years if not treated, and most of the time they show metastasis at the time of diagnosis. So what is most important from Yolk sac tumor, they will have a peculiar microscopy findings, what we call it as Schiller dual bodies. So these are nothing but glomeruloid like structures which are seen under microscope. So they will have a central capillary and surrounded by 2 layers of cells. So these are called as Schiller dual bodies, microscopic important identification found by the Yolk sac tumors. Choriocarcinomas, they can be combined with other germ cell tumors or they can rarely exist as a single tumor. Most of the time we will see mixed germ cell tumors. Digital melanoma with the combination of Yolk sac or even with the rarely with the choriocarcinomas. Similarly, they are almost similar to the gestational type of choriocarcinoma. That's what we see in the trophoblastic tissue disease. They also secrete a huge amount of beta HCG and it is act like a tumor marker for diagnosis of these cases and useful for the follow-up of the patients. Remember, choriocarcinoma is highly metastasizing tumor. It spreads through the blood to the lungs. So once you diagnose choriocarcinoma, you have to immediately take the lung x-ray to look for the cannonball appearance of these tumors. Invariably, these tumors are having high potential to show the metastatic deposits to the lungs. And sometimes they can respond to the chemotherapy, but most of the time when they are located in the ovary, they will not much respond. The chemotherapy response is very good for the gestational type, but not for the ovarian type. They are again highly aggressive tumors, highly fatal tumors. Teratomas, very interesting tumors, mature and immature. Rarely we will come across the specialized teratomas, monodermal spread teratomas. Mature teratomas, we also call it as benign cystic teratomas. Alternate name you have to remember, it's also known as dermoid cyst of the ovary. It can also occur on the testes or anywhere in the midline of the body. And very, very common tumors in the reproductive age group. Around 15% of the cases they have a bilateral, both ovaries can get affected. Rarely benign cystic teratomas can have a harbor the chance of development of the malignancies. Remember, around 2% of the teratomas, benign cystic teratoma, can have a malignant counterpart. Most commonly it is a squamous cell carcinoma. Then we call it as the squamous cell carcinoma arising from benign cystic teratomas. Remember, benign cystic teratomas, they are cystic. So whenever you see solid area, that solid area is called as Rokitansky tubercle, which has to be extensively grassed and look for the any foci of malignant tumors. Like any tumor can develop, most commonly it is the adenocarcinomas followed by squamous cell carcinoma is most common tumor followed by adenocarcinomas and rarely even the carcinoid tumors can also be seen. So classical appearance of the cut section of benign cystic teratoma, bolus of a hair, pultaceous material, very dirty fluid, so we always gross it at the last. So any solid area if it is there in these cystic tumors has to be extensively grassed, they can harbor of foci of the malignant transformation. So microscopically, most commonly we see the skin along with the adnexal structures like a hair follicles, sebaceous glands and sweat glands, cartilage can be seen, neural elements can be seen, adipose tissue can be seen, smooth muscle bundles can be seen. So any tissue you name that can be seen in the teratomas. But the component varies. In different cases, different components can be seen, but most commonly we see the skin and its adnexal structures. When you use the word immature teratoma, it is malignant tumor. It is a rare tumor. It most commonly will have the glial tissue as a component. So there can be immature embryonic tissues can be there. And again, they are commonly seen in the adolescents. And morphologically, they are solid. They are not cystic. Most of the tumor area will be the solid. Partly they may be cystic. So what you will see under microscope is the extensive glial tissue. So this is immature appearing, blastemal appearing tissue is the glial tissue. So whenever we see glial tissue more extensively, we name it as immature teratomas. So very interesting type of teratomas are monodermal tumors. So they are stroma ovary. These patients will have follicles, the thyroid epithelial follicles, and they keep on secreting the thyroid hormones. Patient can have a signs and symptoms of hyperthyroidism, and you will see that thyroid is absolutely normal. Then you should think about this paraneoplastic syndrome can be caused by the mature cystic teratomas, a special type so called as stroma ovari. So sometimes rarely carcinoid tumors can be also seen. So they can cause the carcinoid syndrome. Patient can come with a wheezing. You may feel patient is might be having asthma, but no, it is not asthma. It is all wheezes are not asthma. Remember, all wheezing patients are not asthmatic patients. So it could be due to carcinoid tumor where a patient is having wheezing, cutaneous flushing, sometimes diarrhea. So it's all due to the variety of chemical substances that are released by the carcinoid cells, neuroendocrine cells. So what type of chemical substance is released, that will decide the patient's clinical features as such. If serotonin is released, most of the time patient will have this vasodilatation and edema, and patient will have these cutaneous flushing signs and symptoms. So granulosa thica cell tumors, very interesting tumors, and these are belong to the sex called stromal tumors, constitute around 5% cases, very rarely in the postmenopausal age group, but there can be even childhood also, even pediatric also. So we call it as adult granulosa cell tumor if they occur at the younger age population. Remember, they causes the excessive amount of estrogen and it can cause the precocious puberty. So pre-puberty or precocious puberty, and you should also know that endometrial carcinomas, endometrial hyperplasias, breast carcinomas are very very common association with the granulosa cell tumor. So whenever we see hyperestrogenic status patients, we also evaluate for the ovary if at all is there any granulosa cell tumor is there that causing excessive amount of this secretion of the estrogens. So it poses a risk factor for development of the carcinoma of the breast as well as the carcinoma of the endometrium. What is the peculiarity of this granulosa cell tumor? We will have these peculiar rosette-like structures. We call them as Kahl-Exner bodies. So again, in MCQs, they will ask, Kahl-Exner bodies are seen in granulosa cell tumor. Not only that, the tumor cells will have this peculiar coffee bean appearance. So you will see the central groove, the nuclear groove that runs longitudinally along the axis of the nucleus. So these are called as coffee bean appearance of a nucleus. Is very important for a pathologist to identify these granulosa cell tumors. Rare tumors are trichomas and fibromas. Around 4% of the ovarian tumors are trichoma, fibroma. Sometimes they can be bilateral, and whenever they are bilateral, they are known to cause the ascites in 40% of the cases and associated right-sided heterothorax. This syndrome you have to remember. They will ask commonly, Meek syndrome is seen in which of the ovarian tumors? So it is a trichoma fibroma group which can cause the Meek syndrome. So Meek syndrome is a triad of bilateral ovarian fibromas or the trichomas and the ascites and the right-sided heterothorax. Sertoli cell tumors, Sertoli leading cell tumors are also called as androblastomas. Either they can cause defeminization or masculinization. So rarely they will have a estrogenic effect. So patient can have a masculine effect, then you should think about these rare tumors, androblastomas. Patient can even have hair loss and alopecia like signs and symptoms, or there can be excessive amount of facial hairs on the, she can start developing the beard like things and all, excessive amount of hair growth on the face. So second and third decade is most commonly get affected. Microscopically, we will see both Sertoli cells, sometimes even the Leydig cells, and recurrence or metastasis is seen in less than 5% of the cases if you resect them early. So most of the time they remain benign, but because of their hormonal secretions, and they are known for their clinical features. Rare and interesting tumor, you have to remember, you should never forget the Krukenberg's tumor. Primary can be there either in the stomach or in the colon or in the pancreas or in the breast. Remember about Krukenberg's tumor that this is bilateral involvement of the ovary. Ovaries will retain the shape, but they are hugely enlarged in size. So if at all you take a section, you will see the adenocarcinomas. Adenocarcinoma is not primary adenocarcinoma of the ovary, it is the metastatic adenocarcinoma. So then you have to look for primary, either in the stomach or in the pancreas or in the breast. So many, most commonly it is the gastric. Most commonly the gastric signet ring cell adenocarcinomas, mucin secretic adenocarcinomas will go to the ovary by transcelomic spread. So they walk along the coelomic cavity, reach the ovary and settle there. So this is very peculiar type of a spread of a tumor as such, transcelomic spread. So very commonly seen in the bilateral ovaries, we call it as Krukenberg's tumor. Very, again, favorite exams question. So that's about a few of the ovarian tumors. So have a look of this particular chart. Try to take a printout of this chart and try to remember the entities. So these are the few very favorite MCQs. Read more and more about it and try to know more and more and about the gross appearance and the microscopic appearance of these very peculiar tumors of the ovary. Thank you.